Hello, my name is Danny Nolan and I'm the Director of Chassis Sim Technologies, and welcome again to Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner. What we're going to be discussing in this episode of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner is lateral load transfer at the front, what it means and how to use it. Now, of all the metrics that we talk about in race car vehicle dynamics, lateral load transfer has got to be one of those metrics that has a really hyped up reputation, but when we get into practice, sometimes we find that it has a little bit of a checkered history. Now, like with all things, there are some people who will swear by it. There are other people who will think it's completely useless. Like with all things, the reality of it is it's basically somewhere in the middle. So basically, really where lateral load transfer is used is it's used as a parameter to basically really measure the understeer or oversteer setup of a car. It's basically a yardstick. Now, what it does is it measures the percentage of lateral load transfer across the front axle. And what we're going to talk about here is basically where the lateral load transfer measurement comes from. And then we're going to show you basically some tips and tricks how to use it. Okay. First things first, the lateral load transfer at the front basically has its origins, not surprisingly, in the beam pogo stick model visualization of the car. In particular, what we're doing is we're doing a static balance of our beam pogo stick model, where we've basically placed lateral forces that are balanced at both ends of the car that are balanced with the weight distribution of the car. So we're basically applying a deambulant equilibrium condition, and we're basically solving it statically. So basically, as you can see, with our FYF at the front and our FY at the rear, basically these are distributed in the same sort of weight distribution as the car. Now, the first step in calculating our lateral load transfer distribution is, not surprisingly, going back to basically the quarter car model approximation of the race car. And in particular, what we're using is basically we're really falling on the fact that the effective spring rate is basically the spring rate multiplied by the tire spring rate divided by KB plus KT. Now, in this case, KB is going to be a combined spring rate of our mainspring and our roll spring. So that's something to keep in mind. Now, it also goes without saying, just going back to our picture of the of our beam pogo stick model, all of the numbers here we're going to be looking at are in wheel rate. So obviously, if you've got motion ratios you need to take into account, obviously you need to take that into account. So basically, given the fact that all that we're doing is we're finding the static load transfer distribution of that, effectively all you're really doing is that basically you're solving this for the static case. And really think about it basically as roll springs and main springs basically being applied in parallel. So let's take a look at what happens when we crunch the numbers on this. So what we've got here is a very simplified picture of what the lateral load transfer distribution is given by. And in particular, what I've assumed here is the front and the rear tracks are equal. Now, I've only done this just to make the maths a little bit more understandable. So what we do is we need to calculate a mean roll center, which is basically the roll center height at the center of gravity of the car, which is basically the front roll center plus the weight distribution of the rear multiplied by the difference between the rear roll center and the front roll center. We then calculate a parameter called HSM, which is basically the lever arm of the roll center and the center of gravity height. We then calculate the front and the rear roll springs by basically applying those main springs and roll springs in parallel. That basically calculates what we call the PRM parameter, which is basically the distribution of the front, which is basically the distribution of what the lateral load transfer would be purely dictated by the springs and the roll bars. And finally, we combine that with our suspension geometry, which gives us PRR, which is the lateral load transfer, which is basically the weight distribution of the front times the roll center off the front, and this is basically measured off the deck, plus PRM times HSM, or that lever between roll center mean or the effective roll center at the server at the center of gravity, subtracted away from the center of gravity height, all divided by the center of center of gravity height. So that basically means that basically all we do with our PRR term is to basically multiply it by 100, and that basically is our lateral load transfer. That's what we call our lateral load transfer. Now, a very useful where it really comes into play is it's a really useful approximation to start getting your head around basically what your tire load should approximately be. And as you can see here, I've given you a very, very simple formulation that if you know what your front and your rear air, your front and your rear aero forces are, and you know what your lateral load transfer is, or your PRR term, this is basically a very simple equation to approximate what your tire loads are. Now, actually using it. Now, there are some people who call this the magic number. Well, folks, let me tell you something. I've been doing mathematics now professionally for over 20 years. There's nothing magic about mathematics. Yes, it's extremely useful, but there's nothing magical about mathematics. It's a number. It's a metric. Now, as we've discussed before, it has its origins in a very simple static force balance. What that means is that basically all that we've done is, again, going back to our beam pogo stick model, all we're doing is we're solving for the static case. Now, this is an excellent first cut of how to quantify your understeer and oversteer. Typically, what you'll do is, for instance, you'll take a particular setup, you'll calculate that it's got a lateral load transfer of, say, 53%, and then you'll say to the driver, basically, how is that? They will say, well, it understeered. Then let's just say that you make an adjustment, like you increase the front bar or increase the front spring rate, and the driver comes back, yes, you calculate it's 55%, the driver comes back and say, oh yes, no, terrible understeer everywhere. Then you know, okay, well, 53% was okay, but 55% is too much understeer. And conversely, if you add too much rear bar on and you calculate that your lateral transfer is 51%, and the driver says it's oversteer, then you know that's a pretty good approximation of where you should be. However, and this is the important thing I really, really want to stress here, it's static load transfer only. There are no transients here, so consequently, we're not taking into account basically what's happening when we're talking from basically from the turn-in phase to the corner, or when we're going from mid-corner to exit. It will also struggle when we're in an unbalanced in condition, or we need to take it, or we need to take into account temp effects. That's where the lateral load transfer distribution will struggle a little bit, and the reason it will struggle a little bit, basically because of transients, is that its fundamental underpinning, once again going back to our lateral load transfer here, is that FYF and FYR must be the same as basically what the weight distribution is. And I really invite you, particularly for any engineering undergraduate students listening to this, or recent graduate engineers, to basically work through the derivation, and you'll see what I mean. However, to me though, what the lateral load transfer does is where it really, really shows its worth, is it really gives you a really good approximation in the sensitivity of what you should expect from changes. Let me illustrate to you what I mean. Here I've basically got a little Excel sheet that basically calculates my lateral load transfer number, but you can see here I've also set it up to basically give me of what the to give me an echo of basically what I should expect from my tire loads. Now, here's where I find it really, really instructive, because as you can see here, I've basically got some typical high downforce open wheeler numbers here. And as you can see, I've got my front tire spring rate, my rear tire spring rate, I've got my front bar rate in newtons per millimeter, and I've got what and I should have here. Basically, I've got all my motion ratios, and I've basically got basically what my mainspring and what my mainspring wheel rates here. Here I've set it up for a monoshock, but the principles here are exactly the same. So what I can do here, for instance, let's just say that just going back here for instance, I basically let's just say I'm going to I've got a rear bar rate set at 500 newtons per millimeter, but I've got a rear spring set at 1300 pounds force inch. Now take a look at here. A 1300 pound spring is a 1300 pound spring is approximately about 227.6 newtons per millimeter. But you'll notice here I've got a rear bar rate already at 500 newtons per millimeter. Take a look at what my rear tire spring rate is, 290 newtons per millimeter. So let's just make a quick rib. So as you can see here, down here, I've calculated basically what my roll distribution here, which is 46.86%. Let's go through now and basically do a 100 pound spring change. 1400. As you can see, our loads here haven't changed all that much. And if we go down here to our roll distribution, it really, really hasn't changed that much. So as you can see here, for this particular setup, it's really not that much of a sensitive adjustment for a spring change. However, let's now change the rear bar rate from 500 newtons per millimeter to say 400. Okay, take a look at these tire loads. Look at what happens when I apply them. All of a sudden, they've now shifted considerably, and where before I had a 46.8% distribution, all of a sudden that's jumped up 1%. So really, this is to me where the lateral load transfer distribution is worth its weight in gold. Yes, it gives you a really good first cut of what to expect trying to classify as a first cut attempt of trying to classify your understeer, oversteer, or at least trying to get your head around it. But to me, where it really, really comes into its own is basically really giving you a good knowledge about basically, right, if I've got these springs, these bars, these roll centers, what should I be changing to achieve a big change with the car or a little change in the car? And obviously, if you want just a fine-tune adjustment in the car, basically you want to be focusing where the rear roll distribution is only changing by about maybe 0.2, 0.3 of a percent. But if I want a big change, for example, currently I'm at 47.6% of my weight distribution and I go to 500, all of a sudden it drops a percent. So you know that's another step in your adjustment. And you can really classify this through the lateral through the lateral load transfer distribution at the front. So as we can see, it's an excellent for so this is really the power of the lateral load transfer distribution. Yes, it's a pretty good first step in understanding understeer, oversteer, but more importantly though, it just really informs your instincts about what you should be changing on the car, and it gives you something else to think about. And in future episodes of Dan's Vehicle Dynamics Corner, we're going to take this probably to the next level, where we'll talk about tire modeling. In particular, we'll talk about the stability index, but we'll leave that for you for another time.